Good afternoon. So I'm Bob Weisenmiller. I'm chair of the California Energy Commission. The Energy Commission legislation, the Warren Aquist Act, was a little bit over 40 years ago, so we're not quite as old as the Air Board. It was actually signed by then-Governor Reagan, and it was actually implemented by Governor Brown in his first set of terms. I had the privilege of serving with him then and again. Both when he was the youngest and the oldest governor in California history. The Energy Commission is unusual in that the various of the five commissioners, each of us have a distinct requirement. I am the scientist engineer on the commission. We have an attorney, we have an economist, we have an environmentalist and a public figure. But bottom line is, for those of you who are gone through sort of rigorous academic training as a scientist, which I did, you can move into public policy and be successful in that role. In terms of going forward, in terms of the basic challenge we're facing, and you know, we have 10 minutes, so I'm going to be, let's see if I can get my slides on. Yes, no, yeah, okay. Basically, I think the thing that really drives much of what Mary and I do, or the Brown administration, is the challenge of climate. I mean, the governor has characterized that as one of the two existential challenges of our generation, other nuclear proliferation. And for the basically on the science side, again, it's all pretty simple on the question of, is there climate change? If you just look at the records of the temperatures in California, the 1880s till now, it's 2 degrees warmer now. And what that means generally is that things are hotter and drier. Certainly you could also look at other pretty clear indications looking at the poles. They're much warmer now. You would anticipate they would be much warmer, or one of the first spots you would see things being warmer as the climate changes. And that certainly affects the pattern of climate. A lot of it is driven by the circulation between the equator and the poles. So it's very simple that you're seeing it. And we have done, at the Energy Commission, we have done 3 climate assessments. Our fourth will come out in August. And these are, the last time was 35 studies, peer-reviewed, really a comprehensive look at climate, what was going on. And indeed, those assessments have really driven California's climate policies. You know, it's bottom line is, we are really fact-based in this area, and it's driving us. But I mean, one of the things that really gets the message across, we've also been looking at adaptation for a while. You know, if the climate's changing, how do you change to anticipate that? And this is fires. You know, we could certainly go through other indications, but for us, if you go back historically, we've had one really bad fire every 10 years. If you look at basically the top 20 worst fires in California history, 9 of them have been in the past decade. You know, in fact, 3 of them were last year. And as Ron pointed out, last year we had the worst fire in California history, either by, you know, the acreage, by the number of buildings. I mean, it's damages. It's just staggering what that means. And, you know, I think if anyone wants to take the bet that our climate is not going to be worse in terms of fires 5 years from now, 10 years from now, you know, unless we really act fairly quickly on reducing greenhouse gas emissions, and again, some would say that we have 3 or 4 years to really respond to the challenge, this is going to keep getting worse. And that really means we have to fundamentally rethink how we're doing. Again, climate adaptation, resilience, we've all talked about it for a decade. I guess the bottom line message is now. It's now that we need to act. It's not for your children that we need to worry about how to transform our society. The next one gives the same message. These are fire maps which the PUC and Cal Fire had developed. And, you know, the basic, at this stage, 47% of our land mass is high fire risk areas. Think about that. You know, we've had this general in California, the growth of people moving more and more out of the cities to those sort of edge areas. And as you can tell, the edge areas are getting riskier from the fire perspective. I think Ron said the statistic, so 47%, that's about 10% of Californians. And I think down here, Ron had said it's about 25%? 27% of the area. Now, what does this mean? We were running it, I mean, again, if you look on the potential, just the cost of the fires we had last year was staggering. The damage, you know, $10 billion, 41 people died. You know, again, how much more serious can this get? You know, and again, it's likely to be worse. And we're actually, you know, we're looking at pretty fundamental changes. You know, you can choose to locate your house or your central facility in a high fire risk area, and Ron is obligated to provide service there. And if something goes wrong, then Ron's obligated to pay the damages for that. You know, at this point, we started last year with high fire risk areas in the windy areas saying, okay, we may drop service on certain days. Fundamental questions there, dropping power service, but again, how do you respond otherwise? But again, when you do that, we have essential facilities in those areas. You know, we have hospitals, we have prisons, we have campuses. You know, can you really drop service there? I mean, that's, in terms of resilience, you know, the question in part is, how do we get microgrids for those essential facilities as fast as we can? You know, but again, it just requires a major transformation. And, you know, this is just fire. I mean, we could talk about sea level rise, we could talk about any number of phenomena, but you know, this is certainly serious stuff. And so given that, you go back to, and this my chart is I guess more complicated than Ron's, but you know, a couple of basic things. Ron didn't talk about short-lived climate pollutants, which, as Mary would tell you, is really serious stuff, and you know, much worse than even greenhouse gas emissions. And of that, about, you can see roughly 55% of their dairies, certainly pipelines can do, a lot of things can reduce can emit methane or black carbon, but, you know, dairies are the big issue. And just to, you know, confirm what Ron said, you know, if you look at this point, about 50% is transportation, including the refineries. About 30% are buildings, and about 20% is power. So as you start thinking, well, how do you reduce greenhouse gas emissions so you can start dealing with the climate threat? You know, we gotta think pretty quickly about transportation. And as Ron said, that's also a key part. You know, you're talking 80% plus of the critical pollutants are from transportation. So again, that's a huge challenge, and for LA, where so much of your economy is goods movement, right? I mean, you know, this is like, you know, you got to get serious very fast on transportation, on goods movement. One of the things we've been doing at the Energy Commission, again, short period of time, so I'm going to just highlight, is research. You know, and it's really important to do the science on how we can change things. And again, we have hundreds of projects we've funded, some of them here scattered throughout the state. But anyway, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on each of them. But to really, California has always prided itself on innovation. You know, and having said that, you know, we really need to innovate to get more options to deal with these issues. And, you know, as I said, certainly you could make a case for much more money going in this area. And, you know, one of the real dangers is that the, you know, federal government, as last year it was about $400 million of federal funds came to California for clean technology and climate science. You know, and that's sort of a staggering, I mean, fortunately it's staying about at that level, but it's, as you know, the Trump people keep trying to reduce that. But we've certainly done a lot of investments in R&D in the area of grid flexibility. You know, again, our grid has much more variable resources than the rest of the country. I mean, let's face it, we have about half of the photovoltaics in the U.S. are in California. So in terms of looking at grid integration, we got to get serious pretty fast. Resilience. You know, you just saw the fire risk. You know, it's sort of, we need to get pretty serious, pretty fast about adaptation and resilience. Efficiency. Art Rosenfeld was the prior scientist at the commission, and you know, we really have always made that a strong emphasis. But again, anything we can do to reduce energy use reduces environmental impacts. It's pretty straightforward. So basically trying to really up the options there is critical. And the other thing to talk about is that, you know, we in California, a lot of the existing programs, frankly, are going to early adapters who tend to be fairly wealthy. And so the question is, as you go through on really developing the new technology, how do we make sure everyone can benefit? And so one of the things we've done in our research programs is basically to have a target of 30% of the demonstrations going to what's called disadvantaged communities. And again, we've gone through and tried to identify the areas of California which are struggling. And, you know, again, Ron has said, about 45% of those are in Los Angeles. So, you know, in the Edison service territory. So again, it's certainly a local area, but local issue, but how do we move from basically research on your rooftop solar or your Tesla in the, in the charging side to how do we deal with multifamily housing? How do we deal with mobile homes? You know, how do we basically really move out the innovations and focus more in the innovations on those who really need that help? You know, and certainly Mary and I are both struggling on, as we look at zero emission vehicles, how do we move that out to be something that all Californians can participate in? You know, and I think, is this going to close by saying, the thing I found really great about this symposium was that I remember when I was much younger, you know, at the commission the first time, and John came in and tried to really shake up what was a pretty stuffy PUC at a pretty early age. But one of the things he did was, certainly Ralph, I think, remembers, is a symposia at Stanford. You know, he basically brought in some of the best and brightest to really talk about the types of transformations we needed in the utility sector. That's something which wasn't done before. I struggled to identify, you know, any analogs of what we're doing now. But to really have much more of a higher level of discourse on what do we really need to do with the utility programs. And I would say one of the things that I really gained from that was that's where I met Ralph, you know, who John made sure that he showcased at one of those events as, you know, this guy really knows what he's doing in energy efficiency. And I've certainly really profited a lot over the years being able to work with Ralph. So again, I think that sort of creativity that John used in the transformation, I know as Mary and I both try to deal with our stuffy organizations, it's always helpful to try to look outside and think of ways of bringing in some fresh perspective.